Today's Pro Bowlers Tour on ESPN is being brought to you by Bud Light. Everything else is just a light. And by Truck Guard from Shell. Finally, there's an oil that knows the difference. Now let's preview tonight's top five. Three-time champion Wendy Macpherson-Papanos will open up the championship round finals against 33-year-old Cindy Coburn-Carroll, winner of 12 career titles. Cheryl Daniels of Detroit is qualified in the middle of the stack this evening. She's looking for her first title of the 1990 campaign. Meanwhile, former U.S. Open champion Karen Ellingsworth from nearby Des Plaines will start from the runner-up position, while 22-year-old Leanne Barrette, the tour's leading money winner this year, will look to add $6,000 to her 1990 bank account. And welcome, everyone, to Hoffman Lanes in Hoffman Estates, Illinois, for the championship round finals of the $35,000 Hoffman Schaumburg Open. Hi, everybody, I'm Denny Schreiner, and welcome to the first of nine consecutive Thursday night telecasts featuring the Ladies Pro Bowlers Tour live here on ESPN. And it also gives me great pleasure to reintroduce and welcome back to the microphone two-time LPBT champion, Leila Wagner. Leila, it was survival of the fittest for our field of 79 this week. Only two of the ladies averaged over 200.
Well, Denny, I can't say I'm sorry I missed this week. A very difficult condition. Also, what made it so tough, Denny, was that it was constantly changing. The players you see here tonight, they were able to make those changes quickly, and that's why they're in the top five.
And if they could create any area whatsoever, it was a bonus. One lady who does that very well each and every week is our top seed, Leanne Barrette of Oklahoma City, Oklahoma. Leila, can she become the dominant player of the 90s?
I think if any player could do it, it is Leanne Barrette. She's only been out on tour 4 years. She already has eight titles to her credit. She's got an extraordinary mental game, and she's able to create a lot of pocket area, a heavy roll on the ball, and she's able to strike a lot.
Sounds like a pretty good combination. The percentage of carry, obviously very well, very good for Leanne Barrette. Let's talk about one of the other players, though, that might get to the championship game and give her any kind of a tussle.
Well, I tell you what, I think it would possibly be Cheryl Daniels, the only other player in the field to average 200. She's coming off in a great 1989. She won four titles in 1989, so her confidence level is very high.
Should be an excellent telecast because all five of our players have already captured at least one national championship. So they all know how to get to the winner's circle. We'll be back with the start of match number one featuring Wendy Macpherson-Papanos and Cindy Coburn-Carroll in just a moment. We also have a special announcement from Detroit coming up next. Mr. Joe Antonini, the president, chairman, and CEO of Kmart Corporation. And, Joe, you have some marvelous news, sensational news for not only the players on the Ladies Pro Bowlers Tour, but our fans on ESPN as well.
Yes, we do, Danny, and thank you. We feel the time has come for women professional athletes to be recognized for their abilities. And Kmart is America's number one retailer of bowling products, has taken this recognition a step further by offering the $100,000 Kmart Challenge for the perfect game bowled during a championship round. We're happy to participate and wish all of the players good luck.
And luck is what they'll need, perhaps, if they would shoot 300, Leila, thanks to the good folks at Kmart Corporation, a $100,000 check.
A great payday for that person, wouldn't it?
Oh, my goodness. Well, I'll tell you what, it's tough enough to shoot 300, but if you know there's 100,000 on the line, the knees, I have a feeling, will be banging together a little bit, huh?
Well, we've seen a few men do it on the men's tour, so it's about time that the women got an opportunity.
And Wendy Macpherson-Papanos starts with a strike. Championship round pair here at Hoffman Lanes, 25 and 26. First good look at Cindy Coburn-Carroll since she has tied the knot.
That's right. January 11th, she married Jerry Carroll. And they're residing still in Buffalo, New York.
And Cindy Coburn-Carroll starts with a strike. Not exactly what you and I were thinking we would see in the early stages, as difficult as the lanes were throughout the week.
That's right, Denny. Can you get a good look at Cindy's game here? Four-step approach, very basic, good knee bend, and you can see here she extends through the ball. Very, very low at the line. Good leverage. That's right. We really thought the scores were going to start out a little bit low. The high average this week, Leanne Barrette with a 204, which we usually see the average is a little higher.
Mm-hmm. Only two players averaging better than 200 after 42 games. Good speed and acceleration. Solid 10-pin left that time by Cindy Coburn on the left-hand lane.
spare is very critical, too, this week, Denny. A lot of players leaving those six-count spares, those buckets, chopping them a lot, not quite getting the reaction they think they're going to get. And they made the scoring very tough.
Well, to give you some idea of what we're talking about, Cindy Coburn-Carroll averaged 174 on this pair of lanes, and Wendy Macpherson-Papanos averaged 176.
Well, I think the key was having the right ball in your hand at the right time and trying to get the right reaction. Occasionally, you get the ball hooking a little early. The next time you throw it, it wouldn't hook at all, so... These players really had a lot of concentrating to do this week.
And there were also some big games as well at the other side of the house. Karen Ellingsworth, who qualified number two this week, shot 300.
That's right. Wendy making a great move last night, shot approximately 150 over for her block, so she really came on strong.
Perfect shot there on the right-hand lane, and she leaves the solid 8-pin.
Now the ball's supposed to be taking out this 8-pin, Denny, actually deflects.
Well, you mentioned her run, and she made a very solid run, winning 12 of 16 matches yesterday.
Moving up from 14th yesterday morning into 5th position last night.
It was funny. She said she started the final round in 14th, 200 pins off the show, and she said, Denny, all I wanted to do was get to the top 10, and that was it. Came out and shot 240 my first game and won, and the next thing I knew, I was battling for the show. So it's a long way to jump from 14th to 5th.
Good look at Wendy's game. She has a five-step approach, using the majority of the approach here, holding the ball through the first step, then starting it. Once again, that low knee bend, good extension, good leverage.
Career 13-7 record in the championship round. Between shot, not in and not out, kind of going straight with the boards, but she's hitting the pocket.
Well, it was consistency, too, Denny. If the player found something that worked for them, that's where they needed to stay. Cindy Coburn, she was playing inside quite a bit of the tournament, then moved out during the finals. Karen Ellingsworth, on the other hand, was playing outside the whole week, as well as Wendy Macpherson. So whatever the player felt comfortable at, that's where she needed to stay and execute.
Cross lane, that one better hang on, and it doesn't. So the first mental mistake, Wendy Macpherson-Papanos with an open in the third.
As we can see here, her ball's actually just going to stay in a slide here. Looked like it was going to come back, but just didn't make it, laying a little bit too long.
Ball seemed to skid just a little bit as the 2-4-5 is left on lane 26.
I think we've noticed that from the time the players have practiced now, the lane conditioner has carried down. They're not quite getting the back end reaction. The ball is not hooking that much towards the head pin in the last 10 feet.
These were the difficult spares throughout the week. Cindy told me she was going to move her feet a little more to the left than normal to try and counteract the hook, and she does right there. Ball almost faded away back the other way, though.
I think in comparison to on the men's tour, they actually throw the ball very hard and straight. Now, a lot of the women shoot their spares a little bit more direct, but they don't have that strength in order to throw the ball real hard at the pins.
Let me ask you this. Could you go to a real hard surface ball and basically throw your same type of shot and get no reaction?
Well, that's really what a lot of the women pros do, Denny. They have that extra spare ball, that harder surface ball, to shoot their spares.
Well, through the nose. 3-6-10 is left for Cindy Coburn-Carroll here in the opening match. Don't forget, Cheryl Daniels is qualified at number three. Karen Ellingsworth, former U.S. Open champion, number two. And our top seed this week, Leanne Barrette.
Cindy's 12th year on tour. She is a four-time WIBC and Bowler's Journal All-American.
And no problem with the conversion as Cindy Coburn-Carroll leads by six in the early stages here from Hoffman Estates, Illinois.
Now, for the first time ever on videotape, Brian Voss, pro winner of 8 national championship titles, teaches you how to bowl your best. Whether you're a novice bowler, experienced league player, or professional hopeful, this tape will teach you everything you need to...
And while we were away in the fourth, Wendy Macpherson-Papanos with a spare in the fourth after she left the 3-6 on a shot that looked pretty good, but at the last moment broke through the nose.
Well, Denny, like I mentioned, they're splitting boards out here. The players that are going direct, like Wendy Macpherson, they try to push the ball up towards the head pin. It hooks on them. They move in a little bit, tries to swing it, and it doesn't quite come up. So they're really having to be very, very consistent and accurate.
Nice shot there, though, in the fifth as Wendy bounces back with the strike. Trails by 6 to that young lady right there from Buffalo, New York.
Cindy mentioned to me earlier, Cheryl Daniels has been working with her a little bit, gave her a few good pointers, and it's really seemed to help her in her performance this week. So she wanted to thank Cheryl for those tips, and she continues to strike. She might be meeting Cheryl in the next match.
Little kick of the 10 that time. Six pin doing a little work.
See our low angle. It's a six pin, just love taps the 10.
Cindy's last singles title all the way back in 1986, a long time for her to go without a singles championship. She has 12 to her credit.
She had a lot of shoulder injuries, Denny. She had a problem. She got it back to where it's finally feeling good. She's feeling like her old self again.
This one crosses her up a little bit. 3-6-10 once again. That's exactly what she left the last trip on lane 25. Think she moved?
I'm sure the players always are moving. You know, she may have just felt like the last attempt on 25. She pushed the ball up, so that time she just said, you know, hey, I need a little bit more ball speed. We're always making subtle adjustments.
I guess the trick is to know when you've thrown a good shot and you don't get the reaction you want. Sometimes you get confused, though, don't you? You feel like you've thrown it fairly well, and maybe you haven't. It's tough to get lined up.
That's right. You have to line yourself up to a good shot, not on a bad shot.
And you have to know the difference, right?
True.
A lot trickier than it might seem. Close match here. If Wendy Macpherson-Papanos can strike, she can take the lead. A little more loft on this shot, and she nearly carries the shaker.
Her husband, Nick Papanos, trying to get out that 10-pin right along with Wendy. As you can see here, a lot of pin action. This ball makes a nice break right into the pocket. She's looking for it. However, just flew in front of it.
Well, after missing the 10-pin in the third, no problem with the corner pin in the sixth.
Wendy has 3 titles to her credit, including the 1986 U.S. Open. She won as her very first professional event that she participated in, as well as the 1988 WIBC Queens. So she actually has 2 very large titles.
And the amazing thing was that she qualified number 5 in the U.S. Open, and that's back when they had 6 players on the show, right?
That's right. Came all the way up the step ladder.
It's a long way to go for a major championship, so she does know what it's like to come from the bottom of the step ladder as she leaves the 2-8, and that's the problem the players have had. They get it going a little bit right at target, and it doesn't get back, and you set it a touch short, and it's runaway.
You can see here how the 2-8 is exactly left, the ball coming in very light, throwing the head pin in front of the 2-pin. Nice conversion there.
Excellent conversion of the 2-8. An 8-pin lead right now for Cindy Coburn-Carroll. We'll be back with the conclusion of match number 1 right after this. And while we were away, Cindy Coburn with a pocket hit, nearly tripping out the 4-pin in the 7th. No problem with the spare, and she continues to lead by 7 here in game number 1.
Cindy, the daughter of Hall of Famer Doris Coburn, and her father Frank Coburn, very instrumental in her bowling career.
It's a bowling family. Her sister has a title.
That's right. Kathy.
Mm-hmm. Still looking for our first double here in match number one.
Not easy to find. That's it. These players really were on with their spares. They were able to stay out of trouble, and that was the key this week, Denny, if you didn't throw too many of those low games.
Well, there you see the adjustment the last two times. The 3-6-10 was left on the left-hand lane. Those shots going through the nose. This time she misses the head pin to the right.
As we can see here, she definitely made the adjustment off the 3-6-10, and the ball going straight down, never breaking up into the pocket. It's almost like a reverse block. If the players move inside Denny, the ball's going to hook a little early for them. So they're trying to play outside, trying to play a very direct line up to the pocket. But once again, if they point it too much, it's going to hook early. If they send it right, it's going to sail on them.
2-16, still a possibility for Wendy Macpherson-Papanos, but she needs to start to strike. Really got a tough break on the right-hand lane in the sixth. Could have carried the 10-pin, which would have been the first double in the match. Plenty of room.
Perfect shot by Wendy. Kind of surprised herself, I guess, by her reaction. As we can see here, right around the fifth board, going all the way out to about the third board, breaking back nicely and just perfect. Wendy needing a double right here, put herself ahead in the match.
And for the first time, putting some real pressure on Cindy Coburn-Carroll. Excellent shot. Once again, the 10-pin stands, and can't ask for much more than that.
An aggressive shot. That ball going all the way out to about the second board, making a strong break, good finish, and just wrapping that 6-pin right around the 10. That was a tough break. An excellent shot by Wendy.
So with a spare here, if she strikes out, 196 would be her top score. But for the second time on the left-hand lane, she misses the 10-pin, and she's basically just said, here you go, Cindy, you can have match number one.
The rules of the game is we noticed that that 10-pin was picked up. However, since it did hit the channel first, it does not count, and it is a miscue. As you can see here, the ball hits the channel, then bounces back and picks up the 10, but that does not count. That ball is a dead ball once it hits the channel.
No bumper bowling here on the LPBT Tour.
They won't allow it.
No. Through the nose, 3-6-10 with the 9-pin added. This is a very tricky spare.
A very difficult spare here with that 9-pin. And Wendy is shaking her head, knows you just don't miss spares against talent such as this.
Well, especially missing it the same way twice to the right side into the channel. Well, this is the key shot for Cindy Coburn-Carroll. She converts this, she basically has match number one in the bag. Needs the heavy roll, and she gets it at the last moment, kicked out the nine.
Wasn't sure it was going to make it back, but like you said, the last minute broke back in order to cover the nine.
Well, if she counts 19 in the 10th frame, she is a winner, because that would be a game of 185.
Here you can see the ball, the last minute, just tapping out the 9-pin.
The best that Wendy Macpherson-Papanos could shoot would be 184 if she would strike out, but the key right now, good count and get a mark.
Cindy definitely needs to mark here.
The nose, and fortunate to leave just the 6 and the 10.
Like you mentioned, fortunate, because this ball is going to break right through the nose. She almost leaves the 7-pin. However, it falls, and she gets away with leaving just the 6-10. Switching to a harder surface ball, as Wendy did for her 10-pin.
the key is count. If she strikes here, she forces Wendy to strike out to tie.
We have a possible tie.
There you go. Of course, warming up in the wing, Cheryl Daniels of Detroit, Michigan, Karen Ellingsreich to force Wendy Macpherson-Papanos to strike out to tie.
Looking for the light hit, doesn't quite get it, leaving herself with a two pin and a 183 for Cindy Coburn-Carroll.
Well, we talked about what happened throughout the week. Leila, here is a player that does not miss a spare, no open frames, and she shoots 183.
Low count.
Difficult conditions.
Wendy Macpherson, two strikes and nine ties, three strikes wins.
Doesn't quite happen as she leaves the 2-8. So, Wendy Macpherson-Papanos will finish up fifth this week, and Cindy Coburn-Carroll breathes a sigh of relief. She gets to bowl at least one more game. Like the fact that Wendy went up there aggressively and made the shot and trusted it. That's what you have to do in crucial situations.
You do. She really did execute well on that shot. Just didn't break back and just going up and going for the spare there.
Doesn't make any difference. Wendy Macpherson-Papanos with a fifth-place finish. Meanwhile, Cindy Coburn-Carroll moves on into game number two as she takes on her buddy. USA member Debbie McMullen out of Denver, Colorado. Kim Terrell, who had an outstanding February tour on ESPN in the number 11 slot. And, of course, Denise Rathbun finishing up 15th this week.
And Jeannie Maiden finishing in 16th. And there you go, Player of the Year 1989, Robin Romeo in 22nd. And our alternate this week, Lisa Wagner.
Chris McCune, we might add, the only amateur in the top 24, and so a big week for her. Ah, look at Cheryl Daniels out of Detroit. She'll take on Cindy Coburn-Carroll here in game number two of the championship finals of the $35,000 Hoffman Schaumburg Open.
And what a turnaround this lady has made in her career in 1989, winning four titles. She was the runner-up player of the year to Robin Romeo.
And a player more than likely that will open up some area in the lane as she strikes on lane 25.
Yes, very, very strong player.
I want to discuss area with you after this shot right here, Leila, and basically what it is and how you create it. Hit that time as the soft 10 is left for Cindy Coburn-Carroll on her opening shot.
You mentioned half hit. That's where the six pin lies in the channel, doesn't do its job and take out the 10. It's just not quite driving hard enough.
Why doesn't it drive?
The ball's not finishing hard enough, doesn't have enough roll.
Or enough velocity?
Or speed. Enough velocity. Mm-hmm.
Well, Cindy Coburn-Carroll has done one thing well here in the early stages. She has made her spares.
Yes, with a clean game in the first game. As you can see here, her last shot, and this is where the six pin just sits in the channel. The ball really not driving off to the left, just deflecting straight back.
That's the way match number one finished up. Wendy Macpherson-Papanos had a shot in the 10th. If she would have struck out, she could have won. Well, the adjustment has been made now in lane 25 for Cindy Coburn-Carroll, and she X's in the second frame. But let's get back and talk about creating area, Leila.
Well, as we mentioned in the opening, too, as well as Leanne Barrette, Cheryl Daniels, they're very strong players. They're able to swing the ball out to the right, create the area, the boards, cross the boards. Now, the lane is divided up in boards. They're able to swing the ball and get it back with a lot of velocity and revolutions to hit.
Mm-hmm.
As we say that, she misses the head pin.
Well, it's her first shot here on
right.
The right-hand lane, and that's how tricky they have been. In other words, Cheryl, I think one of the keys this week, too, players have had one lane pretty well zeroed in, and the other lane's giving them all sorts of problems. That's why there haven't been high scores, because they don't string strikes.
And also crossing pair to pair, Denny, they found a big difference in the pairs.
No problem with the spare in the second for Cheryl Daniels.
It's we can take a look at her game. Not much backswing, not much push away. This is where her strength, she has a four-step approach, starts the ball very long, very low. Here she comes in her backswing, and look at the knee bend again and the leverage. This is the upper body strength that Cheryl has and that wrist strength.
Thumb pops out, ball rolls up, and rolls right through the nose, and a split for Cheryl Daniels in the third.
Now really hitting the ball, and this is what happened. She actually came around it a little bit too much instead of underneath, and the ball hooked through the nose.
Tendency is to probably try and help it a little bit when you know the lanes are a little tighter.
Well, when you don't have the confidence on the lanes and you don't feel quite comfortable with it, you do try to help it. And that's why there haven't been that many high scores. The players weren't able to get loose enough in order to string a lot of strikes.
Well, we're still waiting for our first double here this evening. This could be it for Cindy Coburn-Carroll as Cheryl Daniels finds herself trailing here in match number two.
I think the Kmart challenge might be safe this evening, Denny.
You never know.
Never know, though.
Well, just the two pin standing as Coburn-Carroll gets a break of sorts.
Staying safe.
Now, we mentioned that the five players that survived the 42-game test this week are all players that are very good spare shooters, players that are able to just latch onto a shot and kind of grind it out. And sometimes it isn't pretty, but it's not necessarily bad. Those kind of tournaments are fun, I think, for the players in some instances. It's just you're never really out of it.
No, that's exactly right. Like Wendy Macpherson had mentioned earlier to me, she said, you know, I was just going for the top 10. Well, everything changes. You bowl one big game, another player bowls a bad game, and it just turns around.
Well, I don't know. I'm not a proponent of the ultra-high scores across the nation as far as the game of bowling is concerned. It's nice to see 200 to be a good score once again, and 215, 220, a premium game as opposed to people averaging 230.
Well, spare shooting is really what the game should be all about, Denny, and if you can be accurate in striking, and that's, like you said, that's where a condition like this really brings out consistency.
Well, there you see a slight edge in the championship round, but the washout will have to be made now. She has picked up just about everything else.
Wanting to hit left of the head pin, however, that ball hooked early, didn't make it.
So an open for Coburn-Carroll, and that closes this matchup considerably here as we near the halfway point. Well, while we were away, Cheryl Daniels nearly dumped one in the channel as she leaves the 2-4-10. This ball is on the half board.
Well, trust is a must, but this almost took the cake. That ball was three-quarters of the way in the channel before it made a left turn.
And unable to convert the 2-4-10, so it's back-to-back opens for Cheryl Daniels, and she comes back, though, with a strike in the fifth, and she'll have to pick up the pace if she hopes to advance.
Both these players visiting Bermuda last June, along with Dee Dee Davidson and Alita Sill, wanted to wish the Bermuda Bowling Club all the best and let them know that they were rooting for them.
The least they could do would be to send some weather our way.
Ah, that would be wonderful. This Chicago wind just bites right through you.
Coburn-Carroll with a strike in the fifth. Maybe things will begin to heat up here. Both players have made their share of mistakes in the early stages.
A washout last time on lane 25 for Cindy Coburn.
Next week, it's off to your neck of the woods, Lady Fairlane's Open in Maryland.
Gaithersburg, Maryland.
How far is that from where you and Marty are?
About an hour and 10 minutes.
Will miracles never cease? A double here in Hoffman Estates, and now an 18-pin lead for Coburn-Carroll.
The ball coming in a little light there, not really driving, but the 6-pin jumps out of the channel, hits the 10, and she catches the double. It was a good shot.
Now it's up to Cheryl Daniels to answer the challenge. More speed, gonna need a little help as the ball doesn't quite get back.
player's really trying to lift the ball, getting a lot of fingers in it, as we say, trying to rev it up. And that can work in a good way for you when there's a lot of oil on the lane, or they're trying to battle that, trying to want to swing it a little bit to the right. They want to hit it.
Cheryl Daniels trailing now by 19 as we enter frame number 7, so time is running out. Four titles to her credit, had a brilliant year in 1989. If Robin Romeo hadn't set all the records, perhaps Cheryl Daniels might have been player of the year.
Yes, she was runner-up, and she's come out strong here in 1990. She's finished 11th, 6th, and 7th in the first three events of 1990, and no lower than 4th here this evening. Possibly still could move up.
Tried to trip out the two. One question I forgot to ask Cheryl. I'll have to check with her after the show. Any new videos out?
That's right. We saw a nice music video there in the fall.
Sure.
She's into writing music as well as performing it. She enjoys singing, and a very good voice at that.
I didn't realize she went to school for 3.5 years to become an architect. Did you know that?
No, I didn't know that.
Me neither. Well, right now she's trying to construct a comeback here at Hoffman Estate. She's going to have to hurry. She's down by 20. And welcome back. Cindy Coburn-Carroll left a soft 10 here in the 7th.
Looking for the turkey and a good shot as she converts her 10 pin.
She pulls fast.
Fast motion camera.
Say, quickest player we've seen all season. Winner of this match takes on local favorite Karen Ellingsworth. That one sat right in the old 1-3, and it's a solid strike. Cindy Coburn-Carroll beginning to settle down a little, Leanna.
It looks like she has definitely found something there, a little bit more aggressive, feels a little bit more comfortable as well. She's had 4 solid shots in the pocket. Cheryl Daniels needing to get something started. She trails by 19 going into the 8th frame.
Could shoot 204 if she could strike out. Watch it. Nearly left the washout. Cheryl continuing to play the wide angle shot.
Once again, sending that one a little too far out to the right. Lane 25, she looks like she was playing a little bit more direct when she did strike. She was playing around the 4th, 5th board. This ball hanging right around the 1 board there before it came back.
By and large, most of the players this week cut that one off a little short. Either played way out or basically in. There wasn't much as far as the second or third arrow was concerned.
No, there wasn't much in. Now, Cindy Coburn-Carroll playing that track area very direct for qualifying, then moving out in the finals, and once again, other players stayed out most of the week. It seemed like you had the out of bounds if you played between the second and third arrow. If you sent it right, that's where it stayed. So if you moved all the way out to the channel, it seemed to be a little bit better shot across the house.
More speed, looking to trip out the two, and it's just not going to be Cheryl Daniels' night. Basically, it's going to be pack the bags and head east.
On to Maryland. But once again, a 4th place finish, moving up each tournament. A solid 1990 so far this year. She's got to be happy with a nice check.
Well, you'll take a championship round finals appearance every week, regardless of where you finish, wouldn't you?
Oh, definitely.
Her highest finish this year coming in was 6th in the Garland Open. Meanwhile, 223 is the score that Cindy Coburn-Carroll could post if she strikes out in the 9th and the 10th.
Not quite getting the lift on that ball. Looked like she really didn't hit it, and it didn't make it back.
There is not much area to the right. A board or two right of where you're aiming it for her, and she'll be lucky to hit the head pin. But an accurate player, and a player who repeats pretty well, so I look for her to continue to hit the pocket. Maybe won't strike every shot, but she's going to hit the pocket.
The concentration in Cindy's eyes, that's once again something in her favor. She has extraordinary concentration.
I noticed you mentioned that she got married this past January, and would that change a player's performance out here when you and Marty got married? Did it change your perspective any when you came out?
Well, I think it changes your perspective. It gives you a whole another aura of being, I guess. You know, you get a little bit more confident. Your personal life is good. Everything's going good in your life at the time, and when that happens, this game is so mental that if you feel good about your life and what's happening, then you're going to bowl better.
Okay. Would that help my golf, do you think, if I went the other way on that? Just kidding.
Oh, finally, a little dice-o-matic in the 10th, and Cindy Coburn-Carroll has wrapped things up. And speaking of wrapping things up, my good friend Lyle Zykes, excellent bowler in his own right, the son of ABC Hall of Famer Les Zykes, who will be competing in the Firestone Tournament of Champions coming up here in 3 weeks.
Right, Les, a bowling writer.
Yeah, Lyle from Palatine, Illinois. That's where the Zykes family resides, not too far from Hoffman Estates. Big-time Cubs fan.
That one rolls up nicely as well, so Cindy Coburn-Carroll doubles in the 10th. And barring any major misfortune, we will have our first 200 game here in game number two.
Scores a little bit on the low side. However, Cindy looking like she's feeling more comfortable. She made a ball change earlier in the game. Seemed to be the right change here.
Well, at least she's found the 1-3 on a consistent basis. So she strikes out in the 10th for a game of 203. Cheryl Daniels will finish up in the 10th frame and collect her check of $1,700 for fourth place. We haven't mentioned yet. Obviously, people realize that there's a new addition to your family.
Yes, we have Ryan. Our wonderful little boy is now 6 weeks old.
And you're feeling fit, and we'll be back in the next 3 weeks. We'll come back and talk further about the latest addition when we return to the $35,000 Hoffman Schaumburg Open from Hoffman Estates, Illinois. Ken Sale, yes. You know, she looks a heck of a lot better than I did after having a baby.
Did you have
No, I didn't, but you would look better no matter what, I'm assuming. So let's talk about the newest addition.
Well,
he was like, what, this long?
Exactly. He's a big boy. 8 pounds, 8 ounces.
Do you have the pictures?
No, well, of course.
Come on, get them out. Do we have time for the pictures? Get them out real quick and we'll show one.
Well, Karen
Ellingsworth is just about ready to start here. Maybe we'll get these.
Here, we've
just
got
one.
Yeah, we got to get one in here. There
right.
We go.
Yes, close there's her husband, Marty. Oh, okay, we're going to do the prize money first. $6,000 for first, $3,000 for second, $2,000, $1,700, and $1,500 here as we show the proud papa. Oh, okay, I'm getting instruction here. You know, he looks taller standing up. Let's lay him down here. He looks more comfortable laying down.
I think so.
All right. Well, having a little fun there. Now Karen Ellingsworth. See, now he's a national star.
He is.
Good.
Well, he was, you know, when I won, he was a national star because it was my doubles partner.
The problem I have now is Marty changing him since you're out here, right?
Exactly.
Okay. Huh. Papa Marty learning all about the little ones. Karen Ellingsworth, first shot, not the one she would like, but she escapes with just the 9-pin.
Coming back with a little smirk there, her ball crossing over to the left. Now, once again, Karen, a very direct player, is going to actually be trying to push the ball up a little bit towards the pocket, knowing that if she sends...
Karen Ellingsworth, winner of the 1984 U.S. Open. And she is trying to get back into the winner's circle.
She also did that from the number two spot, so a little confidence booster there if she can remember back to 1984.
She's made some major changes in her game, not only her physical game, but her mental game. We'll talk about that a little more as this match bears on. Already two victories this evening for Cindy Coburn-Carroll. She knocked off Macpherson-Papanos, 183-163 in match number one, and then just disposed of Cheryl Daniels, 203-169.
Actually throwing seven strikes in that 203 game, Denny. However, they just weren't all together.
Through the nose,
Apparently, being the 6'10", I kidded with Cindy when she came over to get a drink of water during that last commercial. Asked her if she wanted a sandblast of the bowling ball to try and get a little more grip, and she just grinned and said, "No, I'll do what I can with this one."
Well, you know that's illegal, Denny. You can't touch the surface of the bowling ball once play has begun. So as much as you'd like to do that sometimes, you're not able to.
More often than not, right?
You're going to have to go to another bowling ball.
Spares of the utmost importance this evening, and that lady there has handled them very well.
Only one open frame in their first two games.
That was the washout.
That was a washout.
Right. The winner of this one will have their hands full. They take on 22-year-old Leanne Barrette, a twister from Oklahoma City. Once again, the light hit. Not the result she was looking for, but she leaves the half seven.
Really not the power shot there, Denny, as the ball's not coming in really strong.
Let's talk about speed control right now, Leanne.
Well, a lot of the players want to keep their speed consistent. First of all, the women players aren't able to get a lot of speed on the ball. However, like players like Lisa Wagner, as we mention often how much speed she does have on the ball. Cindy, on the other hand, throws the ball on the slow side. But she's able to keep that consistent, and that's what's important. You find a speed that works for you, you stay with it.
Will she slow it down even more to try and get the ball to grab a little more?
Well, it's a little bit harder to control your speed because you have to do that with your timing and your footwork and all. Now, if the lanes are drier, it's a little easier to throw the ball harder than it is to actually slow up on it.
Right. You don't want to decelerate through the hitting area.
Right.
Karen Ellingsworth, very seldom ever decelerates. A very aggressive player from the Chicago area. She comes out and strikes in the second.
We mentioned some major changes in Karen's game here. You can see her start. She has that five-step approach. She's now starting with a knee bend, where we didn't see much of it before from Karen. You can see now she's actually staying down at the line, not coming up on that straight knee as we've seen her do in the past, and it's really seemed to help her game.
She's worked diligently on the mental game, trying to basically just empty her mind, let her body take over.
Sending that one way out to the right, and as I mentioned, she knows it's not going to come back if it goes out that far.
I don't think she got loose on that shot.
Well, trust, but that one, as we saw Cheryl Daniels do, didn't make it back.
Well, there's a whole school now of thought concerning athletes and when they're competing, how sometimes you get so bound up in all the thoughts that you have going through your mind that you basically just want to clear your mind and go out there and execute, let your body do the job.
Well, you train your body with so many games of practice, Denny, that you actually embed that into your mind, and you don't want your mind to come over and take over and start thinking about everything else. So it's good that you can empty it, and that's where so many athletes now are taking mental courses and positive thinking courses and just trying to relax. As Karen shoots the spare, she's actually trying to cross lane and the ball hooks, and this is what the players had trouble with. When you went across alley, the ball hooked early on him.
Leading by 13, let's see if she can take advantage of the open. Not really, leaves the 3-6, that one through the nose.
As I mentioned before, you hit that track area right around the second, third arrow, and the ball takes off to the left.
Let me ask you this question, Leila. Does Cindy Coburn-Carroll have an advantage now, having won a couple of games here on this tough championship pair?
Well, I think so, because she's actually been seeing the changes in the lanes as she's been progressing on to the next game, and she's able to move slightly with them, whereas a player like Karen has just come on. There's been a lot of play on him. She got four balls of practice. Now, that's not enough to really figure them out.
And especially those four balls of practice, well, especially for the top seed, come basically an hour after you have left, and the lanes have changed dramatically normally.
That's right. In a condition like this where the oil is carrying down farther and spare conversions are very different.
Excellent shot for Cindy Coburn-Carroll in the fourth as she leads by 11 here in the semifinal game. We'll be back with more after this.
What's it?
Karen Ellingsworth in the fourth threw a shot basically through the nose, and she got lucky and left just the four pin.
Breaking up the 4-7-10 here, and the crowd gave her a round of applause for that and left herself with a very easy one-pin spare.
Down by 11.
I haven't mentioned, Denny, the players are bowling on short oil this week. 23 and a half feet, they were oiled down, buffed back, and the heads, the front part of the lane, were sprayed. A lot of times that does make them a little bit difficult and different from lane to lane.
Adjustment was made, and there you saw Karen Ellingsworth. I think she felt like she threw a pretty good shot there, and she leaves the bucket, and this was the mystery spare of the week here at Hoffman Estates.
Well, we saw her miss the 1-2-4-8 earlier as the ball went away. Now with the bucket, she's going to move left and try to go more direct at it. Now she just took a step right, so she's really uncertain of how to shoot the spare.
A little guesstimation, and it worked.
That's right. A lot of times that's sort of what you have to do.
You hate to admit that, don't you?
You do.
That was funny because the amateur players all over the country watch the pros shoot spares, and hey, the pros don't always know what's going to happen to the bowling ball.
So much of this game, when you get in the professional level, Denny's instinct. And you know, we teach the rules of the game, and a lot of times we don't always follow them because it's just instinct. In every situation, every spare is different.
Up by 15, looking to make it 25, and guess what? This one is just flipped right back around. Advantage, Ellingsworth.
Disaster here in the fifth frame for Cindy Coburn-Carroll as she leaves the 4-6-7.
Just when it looked like she basically had the pocket sewn up on the right-hand lane.
Well, you try to give it that little extra lift, and the ball just dove towards the head pin.
An outstanding player in the championship round. Cindy's career record now, 42 victories and 24 losses. That ranks her easily in the top three. Now, after the first open here of the semifinal game, that 15-pin lean has evaporated to just three. Could have been 25 if she struck on that shot. Let Karen Ellingsworth right back in the match.
Looking to jump right back in it on lane 25. Oh, a solid shot as the six-pin wraps around the 10. And on a difficult condition, Denny, when you make a good shot like that, it hurts when you leave those solid 10-pins.
No, because you know it's a critical time in the match, and you know you've thrown basically a perfect shot.
Good look at the
shot.
That
ball's rolling there.
That was rolling. Mm-hmm. Threw that six right around the 10.
Stood up on it a little bit at the line, so back-to-back opens for Cindy Coburn-Carroll, and Karen Ellingsworth is in a good position.
Saw Wendy Macpherson do this twice in the first match. So the ball just slides off. Eyes concentrating.
Carry.
She asked it to carry and it didn't quite respond. Leaves the half ten.
Kind of shaking her head. Not sure why that ball didn't make the break in. As she's talking to the pin, she'll say carry. She thought it was a good shot. Well, it was a good shot. And just didn't carry. Once again, the half ten.
That blank stare.
Trying to stare him down if we can't knock him down with the bowling balls.
You have to will him down after a while.
That's right.
A double bouncer to shortstop, but no problem. Takes out the 10. And Karen Ellingsworth, who trailed by 15 moments ago, now leads by 7 here in the 7th frame.
Well, it's nice when you sit on the bench and your opponent throws back-to-back opens.
How would you know? That never happened to you.
Well, I'm sure it's happened once or twice.
Yeah. Have you been bowling at all?
I started practicing for the first time 2 days ago and felt very different. Mm-hmm. But I'll be back in Winter Park, hopefully.
Good. All right.
Yeah, get up. Come on.
Get up, get up. She's asking, and it does as She gets a bit of a wall shot, a strike in the seventh, so Karen Ellingsworth, the hometown favorite, is ahead here in the semifinal game. And in slow motion, while we were away, this was the shot for Cindy in the seventh.
The ball actually just sliding, never getting into that roll. We've mentioned so many times before tonight, leaving herself with a two-pin, she converts the spare.
Still a very tight match. A couple of strikes back-to-back would mean all the difference. 3-6-10 is left, and it's been a struggle all week long, and it's a struggle of wills right now, too. You know the scores aren't going to be real high, but you still have to post some kind of a number.
That's right, Denny. The other player's really not going to hand it to you. You need to get up and be aggressive and stay clean. And that's tough to do.
Well, you're not kidding. Cindy Coburn-Carroll with the biggest game of the night thus far at 2:03 when she defeated Cheryl Daniels in match number two. Spare up in the eighth. Still time, but other time moving right along, especially if Ellingsworth doubles here in the eighth.
If Karen doubles, she increases the lead by 20. This late in the game, putting extreme pressure on Cindy Coburn-Carroll.
Karen Ellingsworth still has room for 221. 191 would be the best Cindy could post. Got a little more finger action in that shot. Rolls up. She trips out the four. So a key double for a very gritty performer, as there you see Karen's parents looking on, and obviously they're pleased. Her sister right in between.
Like you mentioned, the hometown favorite. Karen used to work in Lori Nichols' pro shop here in Hoffman Lane, so she has a little feeling for the house.
Well, one thing she said before we went on the air tonight, she loves to play the outside angle, especially when the lanes are tough, and that's the way they were set up this week.
Well, Karen started from the outside, Denny, and eventually almost all the players went out there. Karen posted the highest game of the tournament. She did shoot 300, as we mentioned before, and that is the characteristic of Hoffman Lanes here. It is an outside condition, so she immediately went out there, even though our lane maintenance man, Keith Spear, did come in and do the lanes. When everybody else was having problems in fishing, Karen said, "Hey, I'm going out," and that's exactly what she did.
Well, when the lanes are difficult and ever-changing and they're hard from pair to pair across the house, sometimes it's best to just kind of batten down the hatches, do what you do best. Unfortunately, she has now opened the door wide open. She really could have closed the match out, but with an open in the ninth, she's decided to make this one interesting.
Well, we've seen 3-10 pins missed off on the right. Now, Karen knows this. It looks like she basically stuck at the line, pulled up on the ball, and it hooked, never slid off to the right.
Never say die if you're Cindy Coburn-Carroll. Comes right back with a strike. And how many times do you see the professionals come back when they have the door open?
Especially a player like Cindy Coburn-Carroll. She has 12 titles. She knows what it's like to be in that situation. She knows what it's like to strike when she has to. Right now, she can actually close the door on Karen Ellingsworth with three strikes.
Two strikes and eight. She's got it won. Can
That's
you believe
right.
that? This has been kind of a give-and-take match.
Trusting an excellent shot.
Well, she rips the rack for the first strike in the 10th.
This is where you can really see the concentration in Cindy's game. Just superb shot, just really hit it, throws the 5-pin against the 7. Her reaction, she's running it out.
Wonder if her husband's running these out as well now in Buffalo.
You bet. Those husbands do that.
Karen lamenting right now. She had the match in hand and let it slip right through her fingers. She likes it. Oh, toughest break of the week. A superb shot by Cindy Coburn-Carroll.
Oh, beautiful shot, Dennis. She just, I think I'd look at the pins that way, too. situation is this. She spares, she at least forces Karen Ellingsworth to double.
Which is really quite a comeback when you think about it. Three frames ago, Cindy was fighting for her life. She came up with a key double in the ninth and the tenth. Doesn't sound like much, but a game of 180 may just get her into the championship game.
We haven't seen but one double this game, Denny, so Karen Ellingsworth to post a double isn't going to be easy.
She's had two strikes on this right-hand lane. She needs one desperately now.
Very aggressive shot as she leaves a half 10, ripped the wrap, and that six pin just sat in the channel.
So this week has come to an end for Karen Ellingsworth, who will remember this match vividly because she had control before she missed a 10 pin in the ninth. Cindy Coburn-Carroll will advance into the title game.
It's all academic now as she picks up the spare.
Karen Ellingsworth finishes up third. Meanwhile, Cindy Coburn-Carroll moves on to the championship game against Leanne Barrette. We'll be back with that right after these messages.
She was the 1989 LPBT points champion, Denny, and how you accumulate points is every event you enter, you are awarded so many points by where you finish.
And if I'm fortunate, Jim will loan me that tie next week. Perhaps I could wear that on the air. Tough to get him to wear ties. He looks so good in them, too. Well, let's take a look at the finalists by round. You see Leanne started 20th, basically took over rounds 5 and 6. A steady week for Karen Ellingsworth. Look at Cindy Coburn-Carroll. Led through the qualifying, then kind of slipped, but still made it to the show.
Yes, she had a little problem last night, but was able to hang on to the fourth place position. And there you see Wendy Macpherson-Papanos actually made the big move, and she did that last evening.
14th all the way to the number 5 position. Okay, good news, bad news. The size of the field was 79. The average to cash, just 188 this week. To make match play, only 189. And to survive to the championship round, an average of just 196.1. Low scores here this week. And, of course, we've already mentioned the fact that we'll be heading east next week to Gaithersburg, Maryland for the $50,000 Lady Fairlanes Open, beginning live on Thursday night at 7:30 Eastern time. And it's so nice for all of our bowling fans all over the country this entire spring and summer and fall. The telecast at 7:30 on Thursday night, so everybody will get a chance to watch bowling on ESPN.
That's right. Live, it's great.
Down to just the final two. Leanne Barrette to your left. She'll take a seat, and she'll watch Cindy Coburn-Carroll, who has already defeated three players this evening, open up the championship game.
Cindy asking for a re-rack, Denny, as the players are allowed one re-rack per game. I'm not sure exactly what pin she's looking at that's off spot there by our camera angle.
Well, Harry Smith once told me that despite perfect setup, you can always see a 10 pin in any rack anywhere in the country. It's amazing. It's such a mental game. And he was one of the best.
That's right, he was. Before my time, though, I have to admit.
Right. You're saying it wasn't before mine?
Well, I don't know. You might be giving
yourself
away. Well,
he used to tell me all those stories.
Oh, okay.
So.
Cindy Coburn opening up with a very difficult spare, the bucket, as she switches balls once again to that harder surface bowling ball. Going very direct from the left side of the lane. Gets it off the left side. Not exactly textbook style, but it puts a spare on the board.
But that's one of those shots, though, when you make it to the left, you walk back, and it's like you've played it to the left. You make it to the right, it's like you've played it.
Exactly. You play it just exactly how you... Now, this is Leanne trying to figure out exactly who's
well, you know
going to start
is.
The match.
That's the famous Mike Durbin method. That's eeny, meeny, miny, moe. I think I'll start on the right-hand lane with an X, the way Durbin always did.
Well, it gets a little confusing, Denny, because the player that starts the match actually finishes, and you're trying to figure out what lane you like and maybe what lane they don't like, and it's not an easy task out there. A good look at Leanne's game. Now, a four-step of approach here, and this is where you can see just how strong she is with that quick wrist release. Oh, great knee bend. Once again, the extension.
I'm going to tell you, from the shoulder to the fingertips, there isn't a stronger player on the ladies Pro Bowlers Tour. Look at this thing turn over. Everybody's struggling getting the ball back, and Leanne is just revving it up and looking for career title number 9.
Cindy Coburn trying to break her singles record since 1986. She has not won a title, looking for that first singles title. She did win the doubles title in 1988 with Bonnie Joel.
And you know what she's saying? Sure, I get to the championship game and I get buzzsaw here to my left. Oh, I tell you, this Leanne Barrette, that we mentioned in the Open, if there will be a dominant player, if there is one to be tabbed in the 90s on the ladies' tour, it has to be her, and she's a delightful young lady.
Well, Leanne's just getting stronger and stronger every year, Denny. It used to be that certain conditions really threw Leanne. Because of that strong roll, she wasn't able to compensate for it, but now she's basically getting stronger mentally, and she knows how to make those adjustments, and she's learning, and she's becoming someone to reckon with.
Well, that's great news for the rest of the ladies on the
tour.
Isn't
it? Does that mean it's time to retire?
Well,
these young ones come out and can do that to a bowling ball, right?
She's only 22, and future very, very bright. Meanwhile, well, this veteran right here is trying to figure out how to slow her down just a little bit here to put a little pressure on, if at all possible. That one was laid down behind the foul line, rolls left to the head pin, and it was nearly cave-in time on lane 25.
Really setting that ball short, Denny, as we say. Just really early in the front part of the lane, the ball immediately rolled and rolled left of the head pin.
You know, it's one thing when you're playing against other players in the championship round, and you know they're struggling a little bit too, and then all of a sudden you go out and bowl the first two or three frames against Leanne, and she's just whacking them. That's got to put even more pressure on your game.
Well, it does, because you know you're going to have to come out strong. Leanne has 3 titles from the number one position, so she actually likes to sit in the wings, I think, and just watch and relax. And like we mentioned, her mental game is very strong.
Youth will be served. So many outstanding young players coming out on the tour from the collegiate ranks as well. Well, she asked that one to kind of stay in pocket, tripped out the 4, but leaves the 6. It's funny because I asked Leanne, hey, did you bowl quite a bit during the break? And she said, not nearly as much as I wanted to. I just got involved in some other activities and kind of getting the feel for my game again here.
Leanne looking down at her finger, actually having a little bit of a problem. She does have it taped.
Well, the first tournament back, especially when you go all the way to the championship round, there's a lot of pressure on the hand, and you obviously haven't been using it. So first couple of weeks, I would imagine that the ladies do have some problems with blisters and such.
Exactly, and not only that, once again, we've talked so much about the mental game, but it's tough to keep that competitive edge when you break for a month and you get back into this competition. You have to really concentrate on every shot, and
And there's also no way that you can simulate championship round pressure, which is what these two players are bowling under right now.
No, that extra little squeeze of the ball throughout the tournament when you really need it makes a toll on the hand.
As we mentioned, this is the first of 9 Ladies Pro Bowlers Tour telecasts live on ESPN this spring. And next week it's off to Gaithersburg. We're going down to Hilton Head, a couple of stops in Florida,
up to South Bend, and ending with the U.S. Open in Dearborn, Michigan. And Leanne miscues here as she chops the 4 pin.
Well, the 4 pin right off the 8. And you recognize that young lady, at least the profile. She survived the cut to the championship round in our final tournament in February. Tori Romeo is our foul judge here this evening.
The foul line judge on hand in case the foul lights do not work and one player goes over the line. They have those judges in tennis. We have them in bowling.
Well, Cindy Coburn jumped all over Karen Ellingsworth when she missed in the semifinal game. Now she comes back with her first strike against the youngster.
Well, she says, if Leanne's going to miss some spares, I'm going to get up and strike.
Ever the opportunist, you know, there are 10 frames in bowling.
That's right.
And I would think a player of Cindy's caliber wouldn't necessarily be intimidated by a Leanne Barrette.
I don't think so, Denny. The majority of the players out here are strong in their own rights and their own physical abilities, and that's what you have to focus on. If you were to let another player intimidate you, you might as well not be out on the tour.
Well, I guarantee you one thing. Frank and Doris are jumping up and down in Buffalo right now because daughter Cindy has doubled in the fourth and the fifth, and she went from trailing to leading by 11, pressure squarely on the shoulders of that young lady.
Leanne actually not having a good feel on the ball the last two frame. She sat down, readjusted the tape on her finger, and hoping that she gets a good feel this time. Taking a deep breath. Solid shot. This feel is so important, Denny, that consistent feel for the consistent release. You can see there, she actually sets the ball right around the ninth board, and it goes all the way out to the fourth board and then makes it back.
And of course, coming up next, the 10-year anniversary of Top Rank Boxing Live on ESPN, an outstanding bout from Bally's Live in Las Vegas, so make sure that you stay tuned. The leather will be flying in Las Vegas. Key strike in the fifth. Can she double to put the pressure back on? A light hit and a swisher, and Leanne comes back.
With that heavy roll, able to strike with those very light hits, as you can see here. The last couple feet, the ball makes that left turn as she's waving it on. And this is the area she's able to create.
Ooh, a little bit of a growl there. Now the calculator.
Cindy going a little bit more direct outside. The ball just stayed in a slide.
Not the kind of shot that she wanted there. Leaves the washout, so she needs to convert this, I would think, if she wants to stay very close in the match.
Looked like she got a little fast on that shot, Denny. Really didn't quite take enough time. The ball never made it back.
From the left.
Looks good. Perfect.
Ah, a little wry smile as Cindy Coburn-Carroll says, I'm not going to let it get away.
Not with this. This is textbook here as the head pin just goes right into the 10 pin.
A classy shot under pressure for Coburn-Carroll. Leanne Barrette leads by three. Keep in mind that she works on the double as we're into the home stretch.
Better timing that shot. And the results?
Feet were a little slower that trip, and you got to let the ball catch up here. These two players have saved the best for last here in the $35,000 Hoffman-Schaumburg Open.
Leanne Barrette just starting 1990 with a bang as she leads all categories from money to points to average.
Pocket hit, this time a touch high, and she leaves the solid four.
Coming up a little bit on that shot, Denny, a little earlier, she really revved it up, had a lot of speed, but the ball just didn't quite set enough in the pocket as it broke a little high.
Not only does she rev it, but she also throws the ball with velocity, speed and motion, velocity. You hit those pins, that's what makes them scatter. Well, she missed one spare. That came in the fourth.
Yeah.
Likely will not miss another.
We have a very close match here as Leanne Barrette leads by two pins working on a spare. However, Cindy Coburn-Carroll is working on a strike.
I guess if there is an advantage, Leanne has it in the fact that she'll finish first. She could post the number.
That's true.
Of course, every player wants to come up in the 10th. And win the championship.
Well, I'd rather post the number.
Good thought. Leanne sends this one perilously close to the channel and leaves the 210. Well, disaster jumps up in the form of the 210 here in the eighth frame.
Cindy realizing exactly what Leanne has done. Leanne this sending this ball way out to the one board, making the break a little late. And you see this left by a lot of the men pros, Denny, when the ball's coming in real sharp and real late, that 2-10 split.
Leanne going to give it a run for the money, and she nearly takes the 10 pin out. But the open in the eighth allows Cindy Coburn-Carroll to lead by 11, and she works on a strike. If she doubles up right here, it could be lights out for Leanne. Trying to get it into a roll, and she leaves the 3-6.
Taking her time on that one, however, a little slow with the ball speed. I mean, one time it's a little fast, the next time it's a little slow.
And we're talking about splitting hairs here on these lanes. As far as Cindy is concerned, now Leanne can create a little more area, but not Cindy Coburn.
Exactly.
If it's not basically a pretty perfect shot, you don't even hit the pocket, let alone carry.
Converting the 3-6. She still leads by 11. Wanting to post a strike here in the ninth frame, at least giving her a foundation.
Cindy could shoot 223, Leanne 212. Perfect strike in the night. So for Leanne Barrette, it's do or die. If she strikes out, she shoots 212, which would force Cindy to double.
And as we mentioned before, if any player could do it, it's this young lady right now stepping up onto the approach.
More direct, gonna need a break, and she gets it. A Brooklyn strike in the ninth. And if you're Coburn-Carroll, you got your head in your hands saying, now wait a minute, how did that happen?
Well, if things go your way, she really hit this ball, Denny. A lot of times that aggressiveness really comes out. She hit it hard and the ball just took off left. And she's talking to it. Oh, come on. Oh, well, I don't believe it, but I'll take it.
Thankful for small favors. Meanwhile, Cindy's going, no, I can't believe it. How could that happen? But you got to forget about that shot.
You do. Cindy cannot be shut out.
Nope, no matter what happens. But a strike here is critical for Leanne. Puts the pressure back on Coburn-Carroll. Trust is a must.
Beautiful shot, as she knew it when she let it go, and the Cindy looks around, a little unsure of exactly what she left. We've seen it a few times earlier this evening, the half 10, the six pin just sitting in the channel.
Count very critical right now for Leanne. She needs a spare and a strike for 192.
And that was written all over her face.
Spare is up. If she shoots 192, it puts Cindy in a position where she needs a mark.
Exactly. If Leanne Barrette strikes here, she forces.
To at least mark.
Cindy to mark.
Exactly.
So count is very important.
Well, not what she was hoping for. Cindy Coburn-Carroll needs a mark to win. If she would get nine out, we would have ourselves a tie. This is for the title. And she shakes them loose. So a four-year desperate without a victory for Cindy Coburn-Carroll is now over as she wins here at Hoffman Estates. The Honorable Mayor of Hoffman Estates, Mike O'Malley to the left, and Mark Giannachini, the proprietor to the right here at Hoffman Lanes, and the winner, Cindy.
Whichever one Roger McDowell has in mind, nothing like a day at the ball yard. It's that season.